Assalamu alaikum, everybody.
Walaikum assalam.
I'm grateful to the Bangladesh Academy of Science for giving me this opportunity to talk about two projects which are really doable in Bangladesh. And if you all want to work together and put our shoulders to it. Can I have the next slide, please? Well, if you look at Bangladesh, it is transitioning to a developing nation in 2026. And it has got aspirations to become an advanced economy by 2041. But this cannot happen by cheap labor and mega projects and economic measures alone. If you look at the developed countries, you find that economic and technological advancement in these countries has been underpinned by strong science and technology platforms made possible by excellence in higher education and postgraduate research. In fact, the research engine for sustained economic growth in developed countries is largely driven by doctoral and postdoctoral researchers, many from the developing countries, including Bangladesh. So for the socioeconomic advancement, Bangladesh must make use of its demographic dividend, that is its young population, develop intellectual capital through higher education, and also develop science and technology and use these resources to build up existing strengths and take advantage of special opportunities if it comes their way. Next slide, please. In Bangladesh, the money available for research and the resources and trained manpower is very restrained. So Bangladesh cannot really afford to spread its meager resources too thin. So we should aim to do fewer projects, but do them well to international standards. And one of the ways of doing that is to focus mainly in areas of research, which have the highest national priorities, which has existing strength, and development priorities of Bangladesh. For example, things that that come to mind are food security, health equity, environment, climate change, green energy, et cetera. And the way to, because everybody doesn't have all the equipment and the resources, it's very good if you could establish multidisciplinary and multi-institutional collaborations between research groups possessing complementary expertise and facilities, both within Bangladesh and with our non-resident Bangladeshi researchers outside Bangladesh. One area of priority research and common interest that can also involve research groups from other developing countries is the production of high-tech medicines, which are affordable for the poor people of Bangladesh and other countries of the world. Next slide, please. Now, how well is the pharmaceutical sector in Bangladesh really attuned to this? If you look at this, pharmaceutical industry, it produces 98% of the generic medicines that are used domestically, and it exports high quality generic drugs to about 147 countries. But while the value of the locally produced medicines is quite high, it's quite good actually, it's about $2 billion. The export earnings from generic medicines at the moment is only about 100 million per annum. And this can be really jacked up quite a bit. And BAPI thinks that the export earnings of generics can rise to about $1 billion per annum in the next 5 years if the API, which is the pharmaceutical ingredients, are active pharmaceutical ingredients are produced in Bangladesh. But it's in the future options that we have the best opportunities. The WTO's exemption of patent restrictions to LDCs has been very well used by Bangladesh for producing all the generic medicines till now. And we can use it for the new drugs such as the biologics and biosimilars till at least 2026. Maybe we can even get it to 2032. I don't know what the situation is, but at least 2026. And one area that really also is in front of us is the production of novel medicines from the local biota. Can I have the next slide, please? The two areas of therapeutic research that provide the best opportunities for collaboration and product development. One is the rational prospecting of biota for discovery of novel drugs. I'll explain in the next slide what I mean by rational. And the development of affordable biosimilar medicines through reverse engineering of very expensive patented biologics. Next slide, please. Next slide. So I'll talk about the rational bioprospecting for discovery of new drugs from our flora and fauna. And the reason I'm talking about this first is because of the excellent talk that Professor Hassan gave last month. Next slide, please. I just want to show you the research process that's used in producing new drugs. The first thing that needs to be done is target identification and target validation, and then develop an assay based on the molecular target, and then screen compounds to find the lead, identify the lead, and then use a whole combination of different technologies to optimize this into candidate drugs, which then have to be chosen by animal studies and clinical trials to finally produce the medicines. Now, why we lose out really in our drug discovery work in Bangladesh from natural products is that this research area, which is supposed to be done by the molecular biologists and cell biologists, either is not done, or if it's done, it doesn't translate into bioassays. And so this is actually not in vogue in this drug discovery and development process in our country. The rest is the same. But what happens is that in the big multi-drug multinational companies, they each have about 3 million or more of very unique chemicals that they have produced. And because of the large numbers, they use robotics to test their samples in the assays they have produced. And the number they find is very low. They find only about 1 in 1 million that has some activity, and then about 1 in 100 of that actually leads to a molecule. And that's because there is no specificity. While they're making their assays very specific, there is no advantage in the sort of things they are doing. There's just chance. But we have a chance. We have the opportunity to make this much better, because if we are working with the natural products, which actually come from the knowledge of the traditional knowledge, and also because these plants and other organisms have secondary metabolites, which have been produced by these organisms for their own defense or for their well-being. And if you look at the structures, they look like they have very good chance of being real medicines. The only problem is that we find these structures, but we don't go and produce the drugs. So if you are combining the modern science with the traditional medicine and the work we actually do in phytochemistry and things like that, I think we have a very good way of producing new drugs, to discover and produce new drugs. Can I have the next slide, please? So let's look at that. We have the Ayurvedic and the Yunani knowledge systems already. And in addition to that, we have lots of traditional medicines coming from our own tribal people in the different areas of Bangladesh, the tribal people in the Chittagong Hill tracks, in the Sylhet Hills, and in the plain regions also. And Bangladesh also has a very huge biodiversity hotspots in the Chittagong Hill tracks, in the Sundarbans and Sylhet and other places. So we are really very well placed for that. And that is the reason why ethnopharmacology is so well established in Bangladesh and is highly published. And it's similar with the chemistry of secondary metabolites. You heard the wonderful talk from Professor Hassan. And we are very strong in publishing in that. It's not only Bangladesh, a lot of developing countries are very strong in these two areas. But you know, all those places, very little effort has been made to actually get extracts of these library extracts of these plants and other organisms, or libraries of the isolated secondary metabolites. Because these plant extracts and secondary metabolite libraries are gold mines of undiscovered novel drugs. You can see that there's very extensive and impressive research publication, but unfortunately, these have rarely translated into patents and new medicines, and there are many reasons for that. And one of them is the lack of multidisciplinary collaborations in our country. And we don't have the molecular biosciences really incorporated into the discovery and development process. And this is a weakness that we have to get over. The second is that we are not very concerned about generation utilization of intellectual property. And even if where there's not really money for it, so it is really neglected. And unless you have intellectual IP, you cannot attract money from commercial partners. And the third is there's very little interaction and partnership between academia and the modern drug companies. This is another weakness we have in Bangladesh, which we have to overcome. Can I have the next slide, please? So as I said before, combining the strength and traditional knowledge and medicinal chemistry with the modern molecular biosciences will lead to bioprospecting of natural product and isolated chemical libraries with disease-specific molecular target-based bioassays. And this could result at much higher levels of lead identification and result in candidate drugs which have high specificity and insignificant side effects. Because this is so specific and you're only going for the disease-specific molecular target, the side effects are going to be much less. And it also affords us ample opportunities for generation of intellectual property and for technology transfer. So there is very high potential for multidisciplinary and multi-institutional collaborations within Bangladesh. And we have been, myself and my colleagues in Bangladesh, and Hasina is one of them, and there's Zeba and so many others, we have been working to get these things going in Bangladesh for a long time. Next slide, please. So there are a number of steps here. One is the discovery research. And as I said, the first step is the identification and validation of disease-specific molecular targets, which gives us new intellectual property. But we need molecular and cell biology, genomics, proteomics, and computational biology, plus animal and tissue models to join in. And between the expertise within the country and with the NRB researchers, we have sufficient expertise. It's a question of how we bring them all together. Then there's a question of development of molecular target-based bioassays. This is highly specific, and it's not a very big step from the first step to the step. And if somebody is doing that research in the first step, then it's very easy to develop the molecular target-based bioassays also. And as I said before, we have very high levels of expertise in ethnopharmacology and medicinal or phytochemistry, but we need to produce the libraries, because it's no point in doing it and then throwing it away after 1 year, after your students have got their master's degree and then you don't have it anymore. We have to have these libraries. And because of these, we can identify new lead compounds by screening these libraries with the highly specific molecular targets, and they can lead to new drugs. Can I have the next slide, please? In the case of development, we can use the bioassay that we develop, very specific bioassay, also to use this for lead purification and characterization, and also for checking the different steps during the optimizations stage. And for the optimization of the lead compounds into candidate drugs, we need a combination of technologies such as combinatorial and analog synthetic chemistry. We need computational chemistry, and the ability to produce de novo synthetic molecules, and of course, structural biology. And while structural biology, I know that nobody in the country is really doing much, but we have Bangladeshis working overseas, and we have good connections with them. If necessary, we can get them into the loop. But I would like my friends in the chemistry departments and the pharmacy departments to really tell me and others what our situation is in case of combinatorial chemistry or computational chemistry, or the ability to produce new synthetic molecules which don't exist in nature. When it comes to the selection of candidate drugs, we have to do preclinical animal studies. Some CROs in Bangladesh are doing it. But what we really need is very good quality human clinical trials. And this needs money and this needs effort. And we have got lots of expertise in the clinical sciences, but we really haven't developed world-class human clinical trial facilities. And this is important because in the long run, the more we do our clinical trials in Bangladesh, the better we get, and our people get to use the new drugs being produced everywhere. But we have to first establish our credibility. When it comes to commercialization, regulatory affairs, manufacturing under GMP conditions and marketing, the Bangladesh companies are so well advanced that they don't need to learn from anybody. Can I have the next slide, please? Because it's the age COVID-19, I'll just give you two examples. This is not something that I'm doing or somebody else is doing. It's just a suggestion of something that can be done. So what is the disease-specific molecular target? I mean, the spike protein of the SARS-CoV-2 is a very good target for vaccine, but it is also equally very good target for drug discovery. So it is a valid molecular target because it is the binding between the spike protein, a region of the spike protein, with a region of the ACE2 receptor inside on the surface of the human cell that lets the virus enter the cell. So the target bioassay would be in vitro binding between the receptor binding domain of the spike protein of the virus to the human ACE2. And the therapeutic or lead compounds in the natural products would be one that would prevent or disrupt the binding of the viral spike protein to the human ACE2. And you have to be careful that it does not affect the biological activity of ACE2 or people like me, ACE2 or the receptor of ACE2, because people like me who have a heart problem would be in great trouble. The second example that I can show you, tell you about is the disease of a molecular target is the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. The virus, when it enters the cell, uses the human ribosomal machinery and everything else to produce all the viral proteins. But what it uses to produce its own gene inside the human infected cell is the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. And so it's a very, very important target. And in fact, just saw a report where somebody had actually inactivated this ability to infect this, inactivate this gene inside the human cell. But we could do the same with the natural products. For example, the target bias here would be to have the viral RNA-dependent RNA polymerase and produce RNA from it, and then see if there are inhibitors present in our natural product extracts or any of the isolated phytochemicals, which specifically inhibit viral RNA synthesis. But again, without inhibiting any of the human RNA or DNA polymerases. So these are theoretical examples. And I'll just go for right to the very little few slides of my previous life. Can I have the next slide, please? I'm just going to give a few examples from my research on HIV. As everybody knows, the reason why you have HIV or AIDS, HIV/AIDS, is because the cells that produce the antibodies and cells that are involved in T cell mediated immunity are killed off during HIV. And it's the depletion of the CD40 lymphocytes, which are the actual cells in which HIV actually lives, and they are the CTLs and everything that results in AIDS, progression to AIDS. If you take a postmortem tissue or even a tissue from the lymphoid organs of AIDS patient, if you look at it under the microscope, using tunnel microscopy, tunnel staining, then you will find that all the cells, this doesn't matter whether it's CD4C cells or CD8 CTLs or other lymphocytes or monocytes or whatever cells is in the lymphoid tissues are completely killed. And that's what causes AIDS. And we were trying to see what was the reason. And if you look at all the retroviruses, HIV is one of the retroviruses, there are hundreds of them. There are only two retroviruses which cause AIDS. One is the retrovirus that causes AIDS in monkeys, and the other is the, which is called a SIV, and the other is the HIV, which causes AIDS in humans. And if you look at these two retroviruses, they are the only two retroviruses which have two proteins called NEF and VPR. And that's the reason why I started working on this protein, because everybody was not touching them because they didn't know, they were calling them negative factors. That's where NEF comes from. We showed that the full-length NEF or an N-terminal region of NEF disrupts cell membranes, and it can thereby destroy all types of human and mammalian cells. All the CD4 and CD8 lymphocytes, the primary blood lymphocytes, monocytes, any progenitor cells, or anything that's present in the lymphoid tissues. So we suggest very early on that the N-terminal region of NEF could be involved in elimination of immune cells and progression to AIDS. And I won't go into the research, and we have proved it, and other people after me have also proved it quite a number of times that that is actually the case. So this is a very good example of a molecular target for drug discovery or for vaccine development. Can I have the next slide, please? I'll just show you the primary structure of the N-terminal region of NEF. And this is the 3D structure that we developed, that we got from NMR spectroscopy. It was not possible for us to crystallize the whole molecule with this region in. I won't go into details, but it looks like it is quite clear that the myristoyl group at the N-terminus, the two lysines here in the random coil, the two lysines, and then also the alpha helix here are all important for activity. And it so happens, next slide, please. It so happens that next door to me, there was another person working with another venom, the B venom melatonin. And the 3D structure of melatonin and that of the NEF N-terminus, both the primary structure and the three-dimensional structure are very similar. Can I have the next slide, please? Next slide. So because of the structural and functional similarity between melatonin and the NEF N-terminus, we asked the question, if there is any melatonin inhibitor around, can we use that as a lead compound to find inhibitors of NEF? And it so happened that somebody in America had produced a combinatorial library of a few hundred thousand hexapeptides. And out of them, one peptide, HFRIGC, turned out to be a very potent inhibitor of melatonin. So we synthesized this molecule and tested it and found that, yes, it did inhibit NEF also, but poorly. It was not very soluble, it was toxic. So we set about doing a lot of chemistry, analog chemistry, where we either change the charge or the hydrophobicity or side chains, and adding on things like PEG or different sizes, or adding on fatty acids of different types, and ended up with about 350 or so molecules that we could then test. And when we tested them, we did find that it did inhibit NEF-mediated cell lysis very well. And I'll just go to the next slide to show you one of the assays here. you're taking a CD4 T lymphocyte in which is infected by NEF, but in this case, we just uninfected. If we then add NEF peptide to the solution, the NEF makes holes in the membrane wall, and the lactic dehydrogenase comes out of the cell and through these biochemical reactions forms the colored formozan. And this can then be picked up in a calorimeter. But just to be sure that the positive, there were no false positives, we repeated the whole thing with another assay. Next slide. Yeah, in which we incubated the human cells with calcein, a fluorescent dye calcein, which is taken up by the cell. And if you add the NEF peptide to it, then the fluorescein comes out, this calcein comes out of the cell because of the holes that the NEF has produced, and it can be measured in a fluorimeter. Next slide, please. And this is not the whole thing, but just a summary sort of a slide. And if you look at the green ones, this is the samples where you had NEF inhibition, and the purple ones where you had cytotoxicity. But in reality, about half of the molecules were mostly toxic or had both toxicity and an inhibition of NEF. But there were some others, about a third of the molecules, where there was no toxicity, but a lot of NEF inhibition. So these were the molecules we wanted to test. And I'll just show you another product here at the end. It's shown in orange. And this one is actually a natural product called propolis, which is from the hives of honeybees and comes from the saliva of honeybees. And this molecule is supposed to the bee uses it to line its whole hive with this molecule to make it antibacterial and antiviral. And so it has got antibacterial and antiviral activities. And these are sold in natural, in the stores everywhere where traditional medicines are sold. I was in China to give a lecture at the Academy of Sciences there, and one of the academicians said to me that in our country, we use propolis for a long time for immunocompromised people. Would you like to test it? And so he was very kind to take me to a factory in Hangzhou. And there, they gave me a present of this propolis, which I brought with me back to Melbourne. And this was not usable in these assays because there's a lot of particulate matter. But this is what is sold in those capsules that you buy in the drugstores. And what we did was we took the suspension, put it in an aqueous buffer, shook it overnight in a pH 7 buffer, and the next morning spun it down, and we got purification to about 97%. And this clear liquid at the top, when we added to this, it worked as well as anything that we had produced chemically. I won't go into any more things, just to show you the sort of assays. And these are 96 well plates. So they're very easy. And we can do 48 samples at a time because you have to have duplicates, one in which we have the compound plus the cell, and another one which you have the compound, the cell, and the NEF. So these are very easy to do. And this is the sort of thing I would like my colleagues in Bangladesh working in molecular biology and cell biology and biological scientists to actually get involved and to help to work with our phytochemists and phytoethnologists and whatever other people we have. So can I have the next slide, please? I will now change the topic and move on to protein and peptide-based therapeutics. Till now, pharmacy companies, the pharmaceutical companies, have been producing generics mostly, and they still do, because they are small molecules which are exact copies of the patented drugs, and they can be produced by synthetic chemistry very easily. They are cheap, and clinical trials are not required. And biologics are also patented bioactive human proteins, but they are big molecules. And they originally were were isolated from the human cells, but now they are produced by recombinant DNA technology. And as expected, even for like the patented drugs, they also have to be clinically trialed. But these biologics are extremely expensive. And so there's a huge demand for cheaper versions, which are called biosimilars, for the reason that although they have the same therapeutic properties as the biologics, structurally, they are not identical to the original biologics because you can never do that. Because when you do a genetic engineering or recombine things, you cannot have it exact. So we cannot produce biogenerics, but we can produce biosimilars. And this is something that a lot of people are struggling with back home, especially when it comes to getting approval from the DGDA and things like that. We have to be very clear about it. Can I have the next slide, please? The first generation of biologics were the insulin, interferon, erythropoietin, a number of growth factors. Then they went on to the therapeutic and monoclonal antibodies, which were originally produced by hybridoma technology and then by recombinant DNA technology. And the latest one is the Fc fusion proteins, which where they retain part of the monoclonal antibody and attach it to it, they attach the bioactive peptides or molecules. These MAB and Fc fusion biologics are extremely expensive. And it's because they have the patents and we have to find ways. If you want to make generics, you either have to wait till the patents are over or find other means. Can I have the next slide, please? For us in Bangladesh, the biosimilars are like a low-hanging fruit ready for the picking. Most biosimilars that are sold in Bangladesh are repackaged active pharmaceutical ingredients, which are imported from other places. Incepta in Bangladesh had produced their own biosimilars for insulin, interferon, erythropoietin, a number of growth factors from seed clones, which were obtained from the ICGB. And luckily, I was a member of the Council of Scientific Advisors of ICGB when this technology transfer took place, so it didn't cost as much. And Incepta is now producing the active pharmaceutical ingredient for some of the monoclonal and Fc fusion biosimilars also, but these are from imported seed clones. But if you want to make them affordable to the people, common people of Bangladesh and other developing countries, or even the poorer people in the advanced countries, the challenge is in producing them locally in Bangladesh. and especially from in-patent biologics. The global market for biosimilars when they were doing the first generation biosimilars was 2.5 billion in 2014. And it's, by the way, it looks like it's going to far exceed 69 billion in 2025 and exceed 100 billion by 2030. And this is a very conservative estimate because the more we penetrate the markets in the developing world, the more there'll be of these molecules. So can we realistically ask Bangladesh to aim to capture 10 or more percent of the international market? Can I have the next slide, please? So I really think that this is a golden opportunity for us to produce affordable monoclonal therapeutic monoclonal antibodies and Fc fusion protein biosimilars in Bangladesh for ourselves and for selling in developing countries. As I said before, these therapeutic monoclonal antibodies and Fc fusion biologics are extremely expensive, costing in excess of $50,000 per person per year. So there's a big demand for cheaper biosimilars, and especially for the poorer nations. Bangladesh has, unlike other least developed countries and many developing countries unlike them, Bangladesh has the required competencies for the upstream R&D upstream R&D that is required for producing these seed clones. And Bangladesh is ideally placed to copy and market biosimilars or biologics, which are under patent as it is exempt from patent restrictions till at least 2026. So Bangladesh should really make use of this unique opportunity that provides us a huge competitive advantage over likely competitors who cannot touch these biologics which are still under patent, but we can. We are not under any obligation not to do it. And we can make them and we can sell them. Bangladesh already has a very good market penetration through export of high quality generics in low income countries and also developed countries. And as I said, there's a demand for high quality biosimilars also in rich countries. So this is also a good opportunity for wealth creation. Can I have the next slide, please? Just to remind you, this is what monoclonal antibody looks like. You have a dimer here of a heavy chain and a light chain. And if you make one, then the two of them form a tetramer through these disulfide linkages. Just to remind you what it looks like. Can the next slide, please? These are the first generation therapeutic monoclonal antibodies. This is against tumor necrosis factor. And this was done by hybridoma technology and produced in mice. So they had mouse material in here. The protein was from mouse, and this was from humans. So when you injected them, you couldn't do it again because you had produced antibodies against this and they were rejected. So went to the painstaking work of removing the regions which were mouse specific and replacing them with human codons. And they had this humanized molecules, but this is very tedious and not very easy to produce. So they went on to produce the recombinant molecule, which is still being sold and in great use for people who suffer from arthritis and other ailments. Can I have the next slide, please? And coming back to this antibody molecule alone, again, this is the region which has this the antigenic specificity. And this is the region which is completely conserved. And if you are within the same class of antibodies, IgG1, for example, there was no difference. So you can use this. You can get rid of these two arms and replace it with the protein or peptide, bioactive protein or peptide that is of interest to you. Can I have the next slide, please? And here is an example. You take the type 1 receptor, this is extracellular, and here you have the human IgG molecules. And by the way, this is the domain hypothesis for which they got the Nobel Prize. And it so happens that my wife was working on this very project and her name was mentioned in the Nobel lecture, actually, that the domain hypothesis results were coming from her PhD thesis. So anyway, you can cut this off at this place and you can replace this with this receptor molecule. So this will provide the stability because of the disulfide linkages here and the immunological specificities, but this is the therapeutic region that you have added on. So this is the Fc fusion proteins. Can I have the next slide, please? So what we are trying to do, and I've got some young people in Bangladesh who are ready to do it tomorrow, if we had the money or the resources, is that we can expression vector in which we have this CH3 and CH2 domain, the Fc region of the antibody molecule, including the hinge with the disulfide linkages, to which we can add a string of serines or lysines and have the multiple cloning site into which we can then clone in a protein or a gene for the protein or peptide that we are interested. And when we make one chain, it will automatically form, the two chains will get together and make this molecule. So this will provide the stability and the immunological specificity. And this is the molecule that can move around everywhere to attach to whichever receptor or wherever it needs to work. So this is the molecule we want to produce. Can I have the next slide, please? So I'll just very quickly talk about the upstream processing. What we need to know is the amino acid sequence of the protein that we're interested in, of the monoclonal antibody or of the fusion protein or of the original biologic. And this can be done either by looking at the patent literature, but most people don't actually give the full information and because they don't want others to find out. But what we can do is actually go and buy some pills from the shop and put it in a buffer and then use tandem MS, like the MALDI TOF-TOF MS or the LC-MS-MS for protein sequencing, because this instrument can sequence very small amounts of protein to give the amino acid sequence. The Incepta has a MALDI TOF-TOF MS. I don't know if anybody else has these things, but without this, we can't go very far. The next step is the one where you have to use your brains and to design and the gene equivalent to this protein that we are interested in, making sure that when you design it, that we change all the codons, make them compatible with the with the human system that we are going to put it in, with the right codons, which also produce the highest amount of the recombinant protein. Then we chemically synthesize it. And for the synthesis, you can actually get it done outside Bangladesh. Not very expensive, but this is not the thing to do because you will give away your secrets to other people. So we really need a polynucleotide synthesizer which can synthesize larger molecules. I know we have some in Bangladesh, we can produce 20 or 30 nucleotides, but we need one that can make an actual gene. Then, as I explained in the previous slide, we can integrate this gene into a suitable mammalian expression vector so that the C-terminus of the therapeutic protein is covalently linked to the Fc N-terminus. We do a small-scale fermentation in CHO cells. We can ascertain the integrity and biological activity and sequence the protein back again using this, so we'll know it's the exact thing. And then comes the troublesome part. The selection of clones is very important because to be commercially viable, you have to have expressions levels of at least 4 to 5 grams per liter in mammalian cell culture. And if you want to do it manually, it can take months or years. And there's no way out of, without getting a semi-automated clone selector with built-in FACS where you can do 24 or 48 samples at a time and get the right conditions and so produce the amount of protein. This is a clone selector. I think there's one that Globe Pharmaceuticals in Bangladesh has, but I don't think this pharmaceutical companies are going to make this available to us. So we need one for everybody. We need this very badly too. But once, if we have that, we can not only do this, but a lot of other work. Can I have the next slide, please? In terms of downstream processing, this has already been very well established by Incepta. I mean, I have been involved in this, and they can produce these biosimilars. They have been doing it with batch fermentation, and we can use that to ascertain structure and biological activity. We can produce enough purified biosimilars for preclinical animal studies for efficacy, safety and bioavailability studies. These don't need GMP conditions. And we need some facility like that, not only for our pharmaceutical work, but for all types of molecular biosciences research. But the large-scale fermentation and purification of the biostimulant and the GMP conditions is really needs to be done with a pharmaceutical company, hopefully a Bangladeshi pharmaceutical company, because this is something that research labs are not really attuned to. And I can tell you that Incepta has got the system set up, which are as good as anything else in the world. And maybe other companies have also got it now. Preclinical animal studies are done in Bangladesh by some CROs, but there's, I don't know their credibility or how good they are, but it's necessary. But what we also need is especially if you're working with infectious agents, then we need BCL3 or 4 facility with the specific pathogen-free facilities for challenge studies, so that we can actually challenge live animals with live virus or bacteria and check our products. Human clinical trials is a must, but there's not adequate funding or expertise available in Bangladesh. And regulatory, I don't have too much more, I'll be almost finished. Regulatory approval is we need simple and uniform guidelines. This is not happening very much. And we need manufacture and marketing, which Bangladesh is very well placed. Can I have the next slide, please? So the take-home message, I started with saying that looking at the potential and looking at the challenges. And as I have shown to you, there are two projects here where there's unlimited local potential for production of high-tech pharmaceuticals for us, also for the developing world. But for this to succeed, we need political will and we need coordination and adequate funding. I don't think that's available at the moment. But our policymakers have to really realize that the biggest investment that Bangladesh can make in its own future is education, research, and innovation. And when you spend only 12 to 13% of your annual budget on education and less than 0.5% on R&D, instead of the 2% GDP that's required, then we're not really doing something for reaching the advanced stage we want to reach in the next few years. These two projects I talked about, previous slide, please. Previous slide. Oh, no. That's all right. No, that's fine. There's enormous potential for academia industry collaborations in these two projects. But the real problem I see here is that there's a huge developmental gap between discovery research, which gets our students their masters and their supervisors, their promotions they need. But there's a big difference between that and what really needs to be done to commercialize a biological product. And this is what I call the R&D chasm. And the full potential of Bangladesh R&D capability can never be reached without bridging this R&D chasm. The last slide, please. So I'm leaving the Bangladesh Academy of Science with a request and also a challenge. The Bangladesh Academy of Science is the apex, which has the best brains in the country and the most people with the best expertise. And the Academy should play an enabling and catalytic role in establishing some of the critically important R&D related institutions in Bangladesh. Can't do it alone, but in partnership in Bangladesh with the planning and finance ministries, with the Ministry of Science and Technology, with the UGC and the industry partners, with industry international counterparts such as the World Academy of Sciences, the Islamic World Academy of Sciences, COMSTEC, ICGB, and with development partners such as the World Bank, Islamic Development Bank, Wellcome Trust, JICA, SIDA, et cetera. So the type of establishments we really require, which are immune to regime change, are the trust or foundation to adequately fund collaborative R&D, to fund local research and research with developing countries in areas of common interest, to fund PhD and postdoctoral fellowships, to fund training and visiting fellowships, and fund critical cutting-edge technologies. We need a world-class molecular biosciences research center, not only for pharmaceutical research, but also for agricultural research, for food security, for green energy, for environment studies and everything, which should have state-of-the-art equipment and technologies, and which can act as an educational and training hub for young researchers from Bangladesh and from other scientifically lagging developing countries. This center could be modeled on the European Molecular Biology Laboratories or the International Center for Theoretical Physics in Trieste, or the International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology in Trieste, New Delhi, and Cape Town. And finally, we need a real technology transfer center as a one-stop advisory and support hub for issues related to intellectual property, regulatory affairs and commercialization, with uniform and harmonized guidelines for Bangladesh and developing countries. For this purpose, we could look at the example of the European Union's medical agency, a medicines agency which covers regulatory affairs for all EU nations. And we could have a similar one for us and other Islamic countries, or us and other developing countries. I think I'll stop here and take any questions or any comments after this. Thank you very much.